गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, सॉरी फॉर 5 मिनट्स डिले बिकॉज ऑफ सम प्रॉब्लम विद द कंप्यूटर एंड नाउ वी आर अगेन मीटिंग फॉर द पर्पज ऑफ लर्निंग द बायोकेमिक सिस्टम ऑफ मेडिसिन एंड आई एम क्वाइट श्योर यू आर वेटिंग फॉर द लेक्चर. सो अप टिल नाउ वी हैव फिनिश्ड 9 रेमेडीज फ्रॉम द 12 टिश्यूज एंड दोज 9 रेमेडीज वी हैव लर्न्ड बाय हार्ट. We have learned the theory of Schussler and it's very simple that cellular and tissue level, if equilibrium of these inorganic tissue salts is there, their molecular motion is in equilibrium, then definitely it remains in the state of health. If because of some reason this equilibrium is, this molecular motion of the inorganic salts gets disturbed, then a disease develops. And if you will give that specific salt depending upon the symptomatology or depending upon the clinical features on which you can understand whether patient requires what type of inorganic salt, if you provide that, it maintains that molecular motion again and patient can come into the state of health. So this is simple theory which is there. There was a question asked yesterday that, sir, so much of necessary that there is a law of minimum dose which is necessary, and if we give a single dose of these biochemic tablets, patient should get cured. My answer to this question is very important because the disease which is not a product of a one day problem, if disease has to happen, it takes a long period. Whatever may be disease, if it is an acute disease, it also takes, it requires certain conditions to develop, and then that disturbance itself when accumulated, then it develops as a disease. The predisposition should be there. Second important thing, the condition should be favorable. Then third thing, the constitution should matter, and all those things are responsible to develop that disease, whether it is acute or whether it is a chronic, depending on the susceptibility of that individual. So it is not the product of an acute element or within a day. It's a long period which is continually going on, because of which there is a disturbance of that inorganic salt which is getting disturbed at the molecular level, and that's why the pathology develops. So if pathology has to develop, it's a very long process. We have learned in homeopathic philosophy that law of a biological development. And law of biological development explains you the function creates the organs. So first functions are defined. So first the dynamic thing is defined, and accordingly cell changes into a different varieties of it, and every cell performs their own functions accordingly. In the similar manner, whenever the disease happens, it happens at the dynamic level, it takes long time to develop a pathology, and it is a gradual process. So if you provide a medicine in inorganic salt in the same molecular level, with one dose it will not going to get cleared. It takes some time to reverse back. If your constitution has to develop, it takes long period. Your constitution never changes within a day. It takes long period to develop you as a at present what you are. In the similar manner, when disease happens, it also takes a long period. So if you want to make a change at the level of a pathology which is the result of a long standing process, then it requires a stimulus. It requires a repetition. Gradually that molecular motion as starts getting better, then automatically a disease gets reversed back and the pathology dissolves. It can happen itself also with single dose of homeopathic medicine, but it takes long period because at that time you have to depend on the nature only. At that time you have to understand the nature and you have to wait. If you are giving, for example, patient Lycopodium 30, you have given for 3 doses and you have to wait for 1 month, and then after 1 month if patient returns and there is no change, then patient is disturbed. Patient asks you directly, doctor, when I will going to get a result. In such types of condition, to hasten the process of that at the molecular level, biochemic remedy plays a very vital role. And it requires stimulation so that that will reverse back very early. And that is the reason that along with the constitutional, if you give a proper biochemic remedy, that remedy hastens the process of a cure, and your constitutional remedy works for the causes which are responsible, the dynamic causes of the diseases. So dynamic, semi-dynamic material, all things you have to take into consideration when you are dealing with the patient. And that's why it requires little bit repetition. It is not a matter of a single dose in case of biochemic system of medicine. So that is the my answer related with the biochemic system of medicine regarding the repetition of the doses. And it requires, depending on what type of pathology you are treating. You are treating pathology of an acute disease, for example, it requires little bit repetition for a day, 2 or 5 days. But if it is chronic pathologies in the form of a bony level, if it is osteoarthritis, if it is a cervical spondylosis, if it is a lumbar spondylosis, the bone is the hardest tissue in your body which never gets immediately changed in its constitution. It requires time, and that's why it bears repetition. So calcarea fluor should be given in repeated level at that time. So this is the answer for that question, and we'll go ahead. So revision we have done, we have learned these 9 remedies up till now, the calcarea fluor, the calcarea fos, calcarea sulf. So 3 calcareas we have discussed in detail. The fluor having very typical action on bones, dental caries or enamel of the teeth, and as well as vessels and vascular muscles over the vessels, and that's why it plays pathologies over there. Second is calcarea fluor. Calcarea fos is the remedy for the regeneration. It is the formation of tissues, formation of cells. It plays a very vital role. And third remedy is the calcarea sulf, having very small action at the bile level, affecting absorption of the dead RBC. And that's why it remains, those RBCs never taken up by the lymphatics or blood vessel, remains over there, finds it out vent in the form of skin eruptions, skin problems. That is calcarea sulf. Ferrum fos, we have learned, is the remedy for hyperemia, congestion, first stage of inflammation, and that's why it is good remedy for in the formation of a blood corpuscle as well as in the leukemia. Ferrum fos plays very vital role. Kalirumur miraticum, second stage of inflammation where plastic exudate happens to be there. So second stage of inflammation is nothing but the exudation process. So in cases of any discharge from the ears, very typical of a echorous discharge, plastic-like discharge from the ear, typical of a Kali miraticum with eustachian catarrh, along with joint effusion, Kalimur plays very vital role. Kali sulf, it is a little bit higher stage, third stage of inflammation, which you can find it out. Early stage is calcarea sulf, latter stage of third stage of inflammation is Kali sulf, where there is typical yellowish discharge, yellowish coating on the tongue. No, very clear cut indication for the Kali sulfuricum. Then we have learned MacFoss, the remedy having very typical cramps, spasms everywhere. So it is very important ingredient in the any type of convulsions, nerve pathology, neuropathy or nerve tonic. This plays very vital role over there. And last remedy, the detailed physiological-chemical data which we have learned in yesterday's lecture is about the natrium muriaticum. So Natremur is the remedy which has its own power. It is very deep acting remedy. Everyone knows the Natremur, but we have learned Natremur from Materia Medica point of view, homeopathic point of view earlier. Yesterday we have learned it at the physiologic pathological level, and that's what the Natremur is there. So Natremur typically produces a very typical discharges from the nose, from the ears. It is very watery fluid which runs over there, and that Natremur salt which has the capacity to absorb the water, if Natremur is lacking, it never holds the water and it is thrown away. So from the eyes, from the nose, from the ears or in the intestinal canal, the watery diarrhea, these are the very typical with the Natremur, and how it develops, that also we have learned. Those who have joined today should have All those things, all videos uploaded on the YouTube channel, the Dr. Prasad Rasal, the Divine School of Homeopathy. Go through that, subscribe the channel so that you can learn all those remedies and along with lot of things regarding the homeopathy. Today we are going to learn very important remedy, and that remedy is the Natrum Phosphoricum. So Natrum Phos, very important thing, I will not go into the first part about Natrum Phosphoricum that is there everywhere. We'll directly start with the physiological-chemical data. And this is very important to understand. Natrum Phos is having little bit very important action at the chemical levels in the process of a digestion, in the process of the assimilation. And that's why one has to understand all those processes which happens to be there. So this is very important to understand, then you apply Natrum Phos very easily. So today you must concentrate every sentence over here, you have to understand, because without that you cannot prescribe the Natrum Phos in the biochemic system. This salt is found in the blood in the proportion of 0.3 to 0.5 as to 1000. So that is 1000 means 1000 ml in the muscles, in the nerves, in the brain cells, as well as in the intercellular fluid. But this is very important participant in the muscles, nerves, brain cells, but in the GI tract it plays very vital role. Through the presence of this salt, now understand this through the presence of this salt, so in the presence of Natrum Phos, lactic acid is decomposed to the carbonic acid and water. You will ask me, what is lactic acid? Lactic acid is nothing but the product of a muscle utilization of a glycogen. So glycogen is stored in your muscles for the purpose of energy. So whenever you walk, whenever you run, whenever you exert, that energy is created from the glycogen, and that glycogen, whenever it metabolizes, the lactic acid happens. And if it remains over there, it produces exhaustion, it produces a effete feeling, that is worn out feeling. So what is necessary at that time is to remove that lactic acid from that area. That specific action is done with the help of a Natrum Phosphoricum. It never takes part in that process, that's why it acts as a catalysis. So in the presence of Natrum Phos, lactic acid is decomposed into carbonic acid and water. Now what has happened? Basically, lactic acid, which was created as a result of a glycogen which is utilized, that is divided into or decomposed into carbonic acid and water with the help of Natrum Phos. Now what happened? Now Natrum Phos plays a role over there. It absorbs the carbonic acid, taking up two molecules for every molecule of itself. So for every molecule of Natrum Phos, there are two carbonic acid molecules. And it carries it to the lungs. So from there, it carries it to the lungs, where the oxygen of the air sets the carbonic acid free in exchange for oxygen. See how Natrum Phosphoricum plays a very vital role in this process, in this specific metabolic process. So it takes that carbonic acid right from the muscles, through the vessels, it carries it to the lungs, and whenever it comes in the lungs, through the inspired air, oxygen comes inside, and that oxygen, what it happens, it works on the carbonic acid, it makes free immediately the carbonic acid, the carbon dioxide comes out, moisture develops, H2O develops, and oxygen is taken up by the iron at the same time. See, this is the process which has been done with the help of a Natrum Phosphoricum molecule, which latter is taken up by the iron contained in the blood corpuscle. So Natrum Phos is the remedy for the conditions arising from excess of lactic acid. So excess of lactic acid, whenever happens to be there, it used to you must provide basically the Natrum Phos, which takes out or which works in this manner, and which is very essential element at that time. This is one part of lactic acid, Natrum Phos, which you have learned. It prevents inspiration of the bile and mucus with crystallization of cholesterol in the gall duct, and will thus remove the cause of many cases of jaundice, hepatic colic, bilious headache, and imperfect assimilation of fat from lack of bile. Now, what happens? We lose the words as it is. What do you understand by inspeciation? Inspeciation is the thickening by evaporation or absorption of a fluid. Diminished fluidity or increased thickness is called as inspeciation. Bile, when comes into the gallbladder, secreted over there, it can become thick. If it becomes thick, it produces gallstones. If it becomes thick inside the bile duct, it produces a biliary colic, or it produces very severe colic over there, obstructive jaundice. This inspeciation is prevented because of natrum phosphoricum. See, natrum phos plays very vital role in digestion process. And what is that role? Here is the natrum. If it is missing, immediately there will be a typical acidopeptic disorder which develops, because that bile becomes little bit thickened in quantity, thickened in its constitution, can develop, produce their indigestion. So it prevents inspeciation of the bile and mucus with crystallization of cholesterol in the gallbladder. So there will be no crystallization of cholesterol. So cholesterol never gets accumulated. So stone is not formed and will thus remove the cause of many cases of jaundice. So see, it prevents jaundice with the help of that. Hepatic colic also can be prevented. Bilious headache can be prevented. Imperfect assimilation of the fat from the lack of bile. So this is very important thing where natrum phos plays. If such a pathology is there, think of natrum phos. See, this is how you have to understand. So this pathology itself is very important to understand where we can get directly a remedy, natrum phosphoricum. It is useful in podagra. This is the again new word for all of you. Podagra is nothing but the gout which happens to be there in the great toe. It is called as a podagra. So it is useful in podagra, gout, as well as in acute and chronic articular rheumatism, being thus a remedy for so-called acid diathesis. So this is again plays a very vital role over there in the process of uric acid. How it happens, that is explained in further slides. You will understand how it plays a role in uric acid diathesis. The role of this salt is in the normal economy, according to Molescott and Schussler, largely consists in the catalysis of lactic acid in the blood. So that already we have discussed. Thus purifying that fluid organ from this effete product of muscular function. Effete means worn out, exhausted product, which transforms stored glycogen into the acid. The liver is a prime and master laboratory of animal body. So all metabolic processes generally happens in the liver. That's why it is called the master laboratory. It is essential to both the nitrogenous and hydrocarbon transformation and to the renewal and depuration of the blood. So in the liver, what happens? There are two processes happens. Liver metabolizes the certain things, for example, a glycogen is formed over there. At the same time, the worn out RBCs are there, or worn out things are there that are also taken away from it. So it both things happens to be there. All this metabolic process runs in your lung, liver. The depuration of blood to the production of glycogen and grape sugar from starchy and saccharine food, and to a higher oxidation of uric acid and other effete tissues principles into the urea, ready for elimination by the kidney and by bile formation, contributes to the intestinal work. So this process happens in your liver. So it takes away, takes inside, or everything is carried over there. The starch is carried over there. Then the saccharine food is carried over there. Fats are carried over there. The proteins are carried over there. And that metabolic processes happens in your liver. This happens, and glycogen which is developed over there, that should be taken away for the purpose of utilization to the muscles. So it is taken from that area directly to the muscles, either from the storehouse in the liver or either from the intestine. And this process happens with the help of an Natrium phosphorus molecule. See what he explained. When inert, this organ falls short of this extensive function. When operative, it exceeds it, and the overproductions appear with sympathetic effect. These functions are principally due to the cell action. Which are cell actions which happens in the liver? Let us see. There are two classes of functional and or parenchymatous cells. First is biliary. The biliary spread out as epithelium in the capillary branches of the ducts, in intimate relation with the blood vessels or in the vessels of the liver, and likewise with the remaining set of functional cells. Vice versa, those of hepatic acini also lying in intimate relation with the blood vessels and to the biliary capillaries with their glandular epithelium. So these are the cells which are the lining over there throughout the biliary tract as well as blood vessels over there. What happens over there? This double duty belongs to the large cells of acini. So these hepatic acinis are there. What it does? The formation of glycogen and formation of uric acid. At one side there is formation of glycogen, which is essential for the cells, essential for the muscular tissue in order to develop energy. At the same time, the waste product which develops over there, that is also happens to be there. Both things should be taken away. That is more important, and that function is carried through the natrium phosphorus molecule. In addition, the old RBCs, red blood globules, are here in the liver, but in the portal system of veins, now become capillary in the acini, are finally disintegrated and new formed globules perfected. So there is again regeneration of RBCs, that the worn out are taken away and new are formed. All of these varied functions, separate as they are, undoubtedly assist each other, furnishing necessary chemical changes. So all this is happening in the liver, and this is happening in the liver with the help of natrium phosphorus salt. This is too important. All this, why he is explaining all this pathophysiology, that in order to understand all these processes happens in the presence of natrium phosphorus molecule. The glycogen is believed to be mainly carried away in the blood current to be stored in the muscular tissue, furnishing motor energy there too, and being chemically split into two parts of lactic acid. So glycogen is taken from the liver, from the intestine, and it is taken to the muscles, and then again after utilizing whatever the lactic acid develops, that lactic acid is again converted into the carbonic acid. That specific action happens to be there with the help of natrium phosphorus. So natrium phosphorus plays very important catalyst role in all those processes. This acid aids in later vital functions of the body and is at last transformed into carbonic acid and water while circulating in the blood. This transformation takes place in the blood of a phosphate of soda, natrium phosphorus, and by a catalytic action of this salt. Any deficiency in this prevents this chemical change, and the lactic acid remains as such. An acid state of the system now prevails. So we at that time explained that patient has an acidosis. Patient is exhausted. Patient is having rheumatism. Patient is having dyspepsia, patient is having intestinal troubles because lack of natrium phosphoricum over there. This process, that conversion of lactic acid into the carbonic acid and water, which never happens over there. According to Schussler, by the administration of a molecular dosis of this drug, this catalytic action is once restored and the acid state ceases and the rheumatic and other symptoms subside. See how classically he has explained the natrium phosphorus. If you understand this physiology, then you can prescribe this natrium phosphoricum very, very easily. So you can think logically and you can prescribe immediately those remedy. Uric acid is kept soluble. Now you will understand how it helps in preventing gout. Uric acid is kept soluble in the blood by the presence of phosphate of soda and the natural temperature of the blood. So uric acid is there, which is waste product, which remains in the blood and thrown away through the kidney. But it is kept soluble in the blood by the presence of phosphate of soda. So phosphate of soda is a very important entity because of which it remains in the soluble state. Whenever there is a deficiency of this salt, uric acid is combined with the soda only, that is sodium, formate urate of a soda, an insoluble salt, and deposited near the points producing gout and acute inflammatory rheumatism. See, this is the reason how a uric acid diathesis produces a gout. During an attack of an acute gout, we find that excretion of uric acid is diminished in the proportion to the amount of deposit of urate of soda around the point. So this is the first reason why uric acid gets deposited in the form of a urate of a soda around the great toe, and that produces acute attack of a gout. So what he explains is the pathophysiology behind all types of diseases. And he explains the role of this inorganic salt, that is natrum phosphoricum. Natrum phos serves to emulsify the fatty acid. Now again a new word for you. What is emulsification? This is what happens. We forget all those meanings. We never learn those meanings, and that's why we never understand them. Emulsification, it is nothing but large breaking down of a large fatty acid molecules or fat globules in the intestine to a smaller uniformly distributed particles, and accomplished by the action of bile acids, which lowers the surface tension. So this is emulsification. So fat globules are there, they are divided into small particles throughout, uniformly distributed, so that big molecule is there, big fat globule is there, definitely surface tension is more, and then it never gets absorbed. But if surface tension is low, then it easily gets absorbed, and this is done in the presence of natrum phosphoricum. Natrum phos serves to emulsify fatty acid. It is therefore a remedy for all dyspeptic conditions traceable to fats or such as are aggravated by their use. Besides combining with these acids, the phosphate of soda appropriates molecules of albumin, which acts biochemically as an acid. So natrum phos acts as acid at that time, and it works to do this work specifically, so that whatever is there, whatever the fat globules are there, they gets very easily absorbed and indigestion never happens. That is another role of a natrum phos. And one more important role which we have to learn over there. So we have learned that it takes part in the lactic acid metabolism. It takes part in the process of inspiration, specifically in the bile, preventing inspiration of the bile. Then it takes part in the keeping uric acid in the fluid part, or that can be done with the help of natrum phosphoricum, and that's why it remains in liquid state, uric acid. Then this is one more we have to learn. The white blood corpuscles, leukocytes or lymph corpuscles, carry the molecules of fat and peptones, which latter are modified into the albuminoids from the intestinal walls to the blood and thence to the tissue. So from the intestinal walls, this WBCs carries the peptones or fat molecules. There are two types of cells. WBCs either carries a peptone, or WBCs or these lymph corpuscles carries the fatty acids. If they catches with the active movement, so they do this by virtue of their active movement. From the walls of intestinal tract, the passage of leukocytes, now laden with peptones. So leukocytes, which are fulfilled with the peptones from the intestine, is taken directly through the blood vessels to the gall. To the gall means wherever it is utilized at the tissue level. And there are another type of lymphocytes or leukocytes are there. They carry the peptones, and whenever it carries the fat molecules, they reach the same gall through the thoracic duct. There are two ways, either through direct blood or either through the lymphatic, through the thoracic duct, and again to the wherever it is required. So finally they reach the tissues through the walls of capillaries. So ultimately with both the tracts they reach to there. For what purpose these fat globules are taken or peptones are taken? In order to give energy. So when they reach over there, here the peptones are retransformed into the albuminoids, and they are deposited and become material for the growth of young cells which are formed by division. This process is done with the help of natrum phosphoricum. This salt plays a very vital role in this process, transforming the fat globules into the albuminoids, are transforming the peptones into the albuminoids, and which is essential for the cell, for dividing and for the growth. This process is again done with the help of natrum phosphoric. If the progress of leukocyte carrying the fat molecules is stopped, if this progress is stopped somewhere else, it is not taken. So this taking away from the intestine up to the site, if this process which has happened with the help of a natrum phosphoric molecule, if it is stopped in their course through the lymphatic glands, skin, bones or lungs, phlegmonous and glandular inflammation and swelling takes place, as well as tubercular condition of these organs or tissues happen. So if it gets stagnated anywhere, it leads to the inflammation, because it should be taken at the proper site, because it is carrying the fat globules. If it never reaches to the desired level, if it gets stagnates, there is a glandular inflammation or a phlegmonous inflammation, and swelling happens to be there, and ultimately it can lead to a tubercular conditions of these organs and tissue. See, this is where the natrum phosphoric is working, and that's why natrum phosphoric is a remedy for the tubercular diathesis, where there is a glandular affection, the glands gets affected over there. So this is pathophysiology behind that. And what he says last, since this stagnated leukocyte contains the albumin and fat, their fatty degeneration is rendered possible. If that cell which carries the fat as well as albumin, that should be taken away, then they can flow, otherwise it becomes stagnated. So long as this has not actually taken place, natrum phosphoric possesses the power to free the leukocytes and thereby again enabling them to carry on their specific function. So if you provide natrum phosphoric, what they do? They do the emulsification of that fats which are present inside that cell, stagnated cell. When it is emulsification done, that cell becomes free of it, and that can move and again works as a function for that. See, this is how it works at that time. So this is done by two properties. This is done by its two properties. It means natrum phosphoric two properties. First, that the emulsification of fats, but a trace of fatty acids is present, and its capacity to take up the peptonic molecules. So both the things are taken help with the help of a natrum phosphoric, and that's why the stagnation gets removed and person can become normal at that. This is very typical pathophysiology, the physiological chemical data of a natrum phosphoric. If you understand that, you can freely employ this remedy in such types of constitution where there are digestive problems very commonly, and with a typical yellowish golden yellow tongue, with acid peptic disorder, a lactic acid diathesis, a fatty acid problem, or fats not getting proper absorption, or there is an indigestion of fats. These things, natrum phosphoric plays a very vital role. And with the help of that, now he comes to explain the general action of the remedy. Diseases of infants suffering from excess of lactic acid, resulting from overfeeding with milk and sugar, this remedy plays a very vital role. See, this is too important. This understanding, if you know this pathophysiology clearly, you can prescribe natrum phosphoric very easy. And there are number of times the children or infants are brought to you, the doctor, yalakai pachat, dudas pachat. This is very common entity with which they brings the child. Yal dud thoda jari jasta jala ki to dekar hata, tel ulte hota, This is the remedy which you can give freely. Elements with excess of acidity. Yes, acidity, natron phos. Keep it in your mind. Nux vomica in the similar manner, natron phos. Thin, moist coating on the tongue. The soft palate also has the yellowish creamy look. This yellowish creamy look, golden yellow ring, is very typical of natron phos vomicum. Sour eructations, sour vomiting, and greenish diarrhea. These are underline these things. Sour eructations, sour vomiting, greenish diarrhea, pains, spasms, and fever with acid symptoms, etc. Acts also upon the bones and glands, lungs, abdominal organs. That also we have discussed how it affects the glands and lungs and abdominal organs that we have learned while learning this pathophysiology. The knowledge of its sphere of action has been much enlarged by Schussler in recent years. It is the principal remedy in scrofulous glands. See, that's what we have learned. Scrofulous means glandular affections, specifically lymphatic lymph nodes which gets enlarged. Tuberculosis. Phosphorus itself is a tubercular, so natron phos becomes tubercular because of phosphorus. Small doses of natron phos given subcutaneously have been found to antidote the desire for morphine and thus break the habit. This is his specific clinical experience which he has added. I don't have any experience. I have not treated any patient with the help of a natron phosphoricum given subcutaneously, but this is shared. One must experiment that morphine habit can be removed with the help of that. That is that he has explained. Now the two important things, the homeopathic data proved under supervision of Dr. E. F. Harrington, Allen's Encyclopedia, as well as Hahnemannian Monthly, as well as in Allen's Handbook and Hearing Guiding Symptom, you can get the homeopathic data regarding the natron phosphoricum in detail. Schussler recommends 6x, either in trituration or dilution. The 4x seems to be proper potency to use in the view of fact of relative proportion of the salt in the blood, according to Dr. Quisse. It may also be used as an injection in the worm troubles. Dr. Morgan prefers infrequent doses of 30 potency. The higher and highest potency have also been employed with the success. Now, the last part of the remedy, and this is one more thing one must understand, the remedy relationship. But when we learn this remedy, most important thing one should not forget, these physiological chemical data. And this is homework for you. You read it again, you read it from your book, you listen it again. If you understand that pathophysiology, you can prescribe natron phos very easily. As a remedy for scrofulosis with similar acid symptoms, compare calcarea carb. So he is explaining the close relationship between the calcarea carb and natron phosphoricum. Both remedies have scrofulous diathesis, glandular affection. But there is a difference. Natron phosphoricum, if you consider the constitution, is little bit weak and emaciated as compared to the calcarea carb, which we know that fat, fair, flabby. In gastric catarrhal affections, it is to be compared with the calcarea, the calica, the nux vomica, the cocculus, the carbovege, the carbolic acid. Yes, these are very common remedies for the catarrhal affections of the gastric mucosa, and this is one of the important remedy. Generally, I suggest whenever the patient comes with the indigestion problems, along with the homeopathic remedy, it might be nux vomica, it might be constitutional by glycopodium, or if you are using carbovege, must use the natron phosphoricum along with it. Or better combination I will suggest is the biocombination 25, which contains natron phos as well as natron sulf. We'll learn that in tomorrow's lecture, because we have to learn the natron sulf first for that purpose, and then we'll understand about that combination. But this helps in your patients. It gives results very fast. And for that purpose, this is too important to be utilized. As a remedial agent for children, for whom natron phos is a preeminently a remedy, where these acid conditions of the stomach and bowels are frequent, compare rheum, where the whole body, but especially the stools of the little patient, smells sour. So compare this remedy. You should use along in the specifically in the children where the acidity, generally children never get so much of acidity, but if you are getting acidity in children, never forget natron phosphoricum. And if the stools specifically they are sour smelling along with rheum, one should consider the natron phosphorus. It is interesting to note the association of peculiar natron phosphorus gastric symptom so frequently verified clinically. What is this? Very important. That it is interesting to note association of the peculiar natron phosphorus gastric symptoms so frequently verified clinically and symptoms of gout developed in the proving. Remembering the peculiar gouty dyspepsia, so dyspepsia associated with gout, both the things at a time, think of a natrum phosphoricum early. We may have natrum phosphoricum a most useful remedy. So underline this word, gouty dyspepsia, write down natrum phos, keep it in your mind, you can use. So patient coming to you with indigestion, dyspepsia along with the gout, no other remedy touches, immediately natrum phos should touch your mind very easily. Compare here colchicum, benzoic acid, guaiacum, lycopodium, sulfur. Because colchicum, everyone knows, very specific for gout. Benzoic acid, again a gouty diathesis. Guaiacum, again gouty diathesis. Lycopodium, you know, it is gouty rheumatism. Sulfur is also there. In itching all over, compare the dolichos, Artica urens, and the sulfur. So wherever there might be itching, think about this, because it plays very vital role in the bile, and it is, that's why the itching also develops in natrum phos. So whatever we have learned today is regarding the natrum phos pathophysiology. I will suggest everyone to open the book or either a video again. Listen them carefully, write, learn them carefully, and understand them carefully. So if you understand this regarding natrum phos, I am quite sure you will use in your practice very easily the natrum phosphoricum in such type of effects. But never forget the word gouty dyspepsia in case of natrum phos. So up till now we have finished the 10 remedies out of this, and my suggestion is that only 12 remedies. If we do a hard work, learn this again and again, keep it fixed in your mind, you can use and you can start developing your practice with the help of that. It helps in your practice. It hastens the process of cure. It builds your confidence very easily. And for that purpose, it is necessary to understand them. My suggestion to all listeners is that if you have your friends who are homeopaths or homeopathic students, let them know regarding our this activity. My aim is to propagate this homeopathy. And I'm not expecting money from you. I'm expecting the homeopathy should reach to the root level. And for that purpose, it is, please, that is the duty of every homeopath who is listening. Ask every student's friends, homeopathic people, to subscribe our channel, go through it, learn and share. Sometimes it might happen there, it is not a complete work, but still whatever I have shared, that is my personal experience. So ask your friends to subscribe the channel and go through the videos so that everyone can get knowledge regarding it. So we'll meet tomorrow again with the next natrum salt, that is the natrum sulfuricum, which we have to continue over there. So this is my expectation from all of you, and my expectation again, one more thing, that learn by heart the homeopathy and come out that homeopathy can become first line of treatment in the medical world. So for that purpose I am doing this work. Money automatically comes, money is not the matter. What is important is to bring this system up, and that for that purpose I require your participation in this process. So thank you for being there for nearly about 50 minutes and listening me. Thanks once again. We'll